by the mid-30s with the Arab-Palestinian revolt, now we have a British white paper that speaks of perhaps two states on Palestine or in parts of Palestine. Does that mean that the British started by then regretting some of the stuff that they were making in the early part of the century?
I think in 1937, when you have the report of the Palestine Royal Commission that, mm-hmm. that sent to Palestine to figure out what's going wrong and what should be the future direction, I think it's hugely significant that this is the first time that the British start to think about what the end game might be. Mm-hmm. Now, the commission plumps for the solution, the two-state solution. Given that the declaration, the Balfour Declaration, was issued in 1917, and the British government only seriously considers where all of this is heading in the long term, in 1937, begs a lot of questions.
Whiles, in between whiles, the Balfour Declaration has been written into the League of Nations mandate. So under the terms of the mandate, the British are supposed to implement it, that carry through on the Balfour Declaration. One of the other things they're supposed to do and didn't do is to set up assemblies of the population in Mandate Palestine for them to participate in the running of their own affairs, and they neglected to do so.
So,
briefly, obvious.
The British wrote the Balfour Declaration into the terms of the League of Nations mandate over Palestine, and then it became a legal commitment. But the British realized in the interwar period that they had made a mistake. They were saddled with these incompatible promises, and they had to somehow manage the two conflicting communities that they had encouraged during the First World War. And there was no solution. There was one land and two people, and this was the conflict was about. The British philosopher Isaiah Berlin compared the British mandate over Palestine to a minor British public school, where there was the High Commissioner who was high-minded and fair-minded and wanted justice for everybody, but the assistant masters were much more sympathetic to the Arabs, right, than they were to the Jewish boys, who had the irritating habit of writing letters to their influential relatives around the world, complaining about everything from the quality of food to the quality of the teaching.
Well, they may have been marginally more sympathetic to the Arabs, but they were arrogant towards both.
I think that the key thing here is it brings us back to the Balfour Declaration, is the fact that the British did not define what a national home was. Mm. And there's a reason for that, the reason being is that, first of all, the Balfour Declaration was issued primarily for concerns outside of Palestine during the war, but also the British assumed that they could easily manage what they thought was mainstream Zionism, which was non-statist Zionism. They also thought they made another significant error in that they thought that the Palestinians were not a nation and would eventually accept Zionism, because they thought that the Zionists and the Jews were quasi-Europeans. Not real Europeans, quasi-Europeans, right, almost white,
they became
but not
Europeans
quite.
When they went to Palestine, I guess.
More European, but never
right.
quite there.
Before we end, I just need to finish up with 1947, Avi. So here we have recently a new classified information or documents released. And I think here the Guardian in April 26 says that the British government knew from the moment it planned to withdraw its forces from Palestine more than 6 years ago, 1947, that partition of the territory and the founding of the state of Israel would lead to war and the defeat of the Arabs, as the secret documents revealed. So actually, their departure was as controversial as their arrival in Palestine.
Yes, and as dishonest as their arrival in Palestine, because during the twilight of the British mandate, they also played a double game. Officially, they disengaged. There was a UN partition plan to partition mandatory Palestine into a Jewish state and an Arab state, and the British refused to implement this UN resolution, so they stood back. But they knew full well, as the documents reveal, that there would be a war and that the Arabs would lose, and that the Jews will come out on
yes,
top.
Yes, but we shouldn't leave the impression that they wanted that war.
Hold that thought, Rosemary. These were the days of empire. As it were, we will take a news break, and when we come back, we'll discuss more about both the British and the Israeli narratives. Israeli narrative, Avi. So here we have a narrative that says, look, this is a prosecuted people came back to the home of their forefathers. They were attacked by a huge number of Arabs and armies, and they miraculously won their independence. What is right and what is wrong with this narrative?
This is the standard Zionist narrative about the origins and the course of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and it portrays the Jews as the victims of this conflict. But in the final outcome, it was the Palestinians who were the victims. There is a large Zionist historiography about this conflict, which elaborates on this narrative. But in the late 1980s, a new group of Israeli historians emerge. Ilan Pape, and myself, I am one of them. And with the help of Israeli and British and American and UN documents, we mounted a frontal assault on all the legends that have come to surround the 1948 war and the birth of Israel.
So why do the old historians refer to you as not new and not historians?
Because they don't like the conclusions that we have reached in our rewriting of the history of 1948 on the basis of the new evidence.
So let's take, for example, the idea that Israel was attacked by a number of Arab armies and they have miraculously won the war of independence against them.
The Israeli narrative says that the whole of the Arab world was united behind a clear war aim, which is to throw the Jews into the sea and to strangle the infant Jewish state at birth. But if you look at the Arab coalition that invaded Palestine on the 5th of May 1948, which consisted of the regular armies of five Arab states plus irregular Palestinian forces, you'll see that it's the most bitterly divided, disorganized, and ramshackle coalition in the history of warfare. And there was no united Arab war aim.
But certainly the Syrians and the Jordanians weren't united. They were actually afraid of one another.
Yes. There was a rivalry between Egypt and the Hashemite countries ruled by Hashemite rulers in Iraq and Transjordan. Lebanon and Syria were afraid of King Abdullah's project and ambition for greater Syria to incorporate Lebanon and Syria in his kingdom. So there are very, very different agendas in this conflict.
What about people without a land going to a land without a people?
I think it's perhaps us dwelling for a moment on the profound connection of what we were talking about before, which is the British connection to the evolution of the conflict and Zionist mythology and also Palestinian mythology. The mainstream idea, sense of things, is that actually the British betrayed Zionism. And on the other hand, a mainstream Palestinian view and Arab view is that the British colluded with the Zionists. But I think it's very important nonetheless that we don't fall into this trap of going one side or another, that we acknowledge that there was also profound ambivalence amongst the British about the Zionist project right up until the end of the mandate. I think there's a continuity between Ernest Bevin, the British Foreign Secretary, who was directing Palestine policy at the end of the mandate, and his fear that a Jewish state would become a satellite for the Soviet Union and feared Jewish communism. And I think it's important that we avoid the trap of falling into two very straightforward, nice and simple narratives that really derive from the beginnings of the mandate in the 1920s onwards about the British were the good guys or the British were the bad guys.
Well, the British themselves obviously have their narrative and it's different from the other two. And it basically as with all national narratives, is about vindicating the establishment, especially the establishment of the day. And today it's too embarrassing by half to acknowledge that the British may have had a profound role in creating the mess that has continued as a conflict ever since. But it's very difficult for all of us to identify any one moment at which you could say that this is the moment for which they must make the biggest apology, because...
Shall we hold our breath, or is it coming, the apology?
Well, once they apologize for one little piece of the story, then what happens to the whole of the rest of the story? Are they supposed to apologize for empire? Are they supposed to apologize for what they thought was trying to keep the two sides apart in a civil war? They described Israeli-Palestinian or Jewish-Arab conflict as a war between the locals, and they gave up trying to separate them. And I think to this day, the tendency has been, not only in London, but also in other European capitals, to put the major onus on both the Israelis and the Palestinians for the continuation of the conflict. They don't want to go back into history for a variety of reasons.
Like that's going to be very difficult, isn't it, after the case, the ruling of the High Court in October 2012, about the case being brought against the British government in relation to the Mau Mau uprising in Kenya, which has opened a can of worms. It's no coincidence that since then...
It's also means compensation, correct?
Yes, and they now have the right to bring a case against the government. It's no coincidence that we now also have a campaign that's being put forward by the Palestinian Refugee Centre in London for an apology for the Balfour Declaration and British colonial rule in Palestine.
I would like to assign to Britain a share of the responsibility for the Nakba. And James mentioned Ernest Bevin, the Labour's foreign secretary. Bevin once said that the Balfour Declaration was the worst mistake in Western foreign policy in the first half of the 20th century. But he was in power after the war, after the Second World War, and he was not moved by any sentiments. He was an imperial policy maker. And there is a debate, one of the main bones of contention between the old historians and the new historians, is British policy towards the end of the mandate. The old historians say that the British, Britain was activated, inspired by strong anti-Zionist and even anti-Semitic sentiments, and that Britain's policy was to arm and to encourage its Arab allies to invade Palestine and put an end to the Zionist project. The new historians' perspective on British policy is rather different. Ilan Pape was the first to challenge the Zionist account, and he claimed that the key to British policy towards the end of the mandate was not pro-Israeli or pro-Arab, it was pro-British, right. British imperial interests. And the key was Greater Transjordan. In 1947-1948, there was a tacit agreement between King Abdullah of Transjordan and the Zionist leaders to partition Palestine between themselves at the expense of the Palestinians. And this is what happened in the end.
And
a subsidiary argument is that Britain knew and approved of this collusion across the Jordan, because the British saw a Palestinian state as synonymous with the Mufti state, and the Mufti was a renegade, and hostility to the Mufti and a Palestinian state was a constant factor in British policy throughout this period.
Into the League of Nations mandate. So under the terms of the mandate, the British are supposed to implement it, that carry through on the Balfour Declaration. One of the other things they're supposed to do and didn't do is to set up assemblies of the population in Mandate Palestine for them to participate in the running of their own affairs, and they neglected to do so.
So,
briefly, obvious.
The British solution, there was one land and two people, and this was the conflict was about. The British philosopher Isaiah Berlin compared the British mandate over Palestine to a minor British public school, where there was the High Commissioner who was high-minded and fair-minded and wanted justice for everybody, but the assistant masters were much more sympathetic to the Arabs.
Right. Direction. I think it's hugely significant that this is the first time that the British start to think about what the end game might be. Mm-hmm. Now, the Commission plumps for the solution, the two-state solution. Given that the declaration, the Balfour Declaration, was issued in 1917, and the British government only seriously considers where all of this is heading in the long term in 1937, begs a lot of questions.
In between worlds, the Balfour Declaration has been written in...
wrote the Balfour Declaration into the terms of the League of Nations mandate over Palestine, and then it became a legal commitment. But the British realized in the interwar period that they had made a mistake. They were saddled with these incompatible promises, and they had to somehow manage the two conflicting communities that they had encouraged during the First World War. And there was no...
By the mid-30s, with the Arab-Palestinian revolt, now we have a British white paper that speaks of perhaps two states on Palestine or in parts of Palestine. Does that mean that the British started by then regretting some of the stuff that they were making in the early part of the century?
I think in 1937, when you have the report of the Palestine Royal Commission that, mm-hmm. that sent to Palestine to figure out what's going wrong and what should be the future direction.